I'm Brendan Nellis. I was born in Belfast and I still live here. Tarlach was my brother, my confidant and my friend. On the 1st of April 2020, he died from COVID-related illnesses. He was just 57 years old. This is my tribute to him. Our brother Tarlach was born in Belfast in October 1962 into a Catholic family. He was 10th of 11 children, 6 boys and 5 girls. He was a happy, talkative, intelligent boy without a care in the world until in 1969, the Northern Irish troubles erupted. The family home was close to an interface with the Loyalist Unionist Tiger Bay area. We became a regular target as the sectarian conflict worsened. Our home was regularly raided by the British Army and the RUC, and no one felt safe. We had no protection, and in the summer of 1972, we had to flee our home in the back of a coal truck. We eventually found refuge in a Catholic primary school about 5 miles from our home. Tarlach was just 9 years old. His political education began as the effect of sectarianism and the denial of civil rights, state oppression, and the imprisonment and internment of older family members had a huge impact on him. These were frightening times for everyone. I will now introduce a visual presentation showing significant events in Tarlach's life. Tarlach's political and radical activism began in his teenage years. He became involved in various nationalist youth movements, including Youth Against Hate Blocks and Lesbian and Gays Against Hate Blocks in Armagh Prison. He also came out around this time and became an articulate LGBT spokesperson within the core nationalist movement, which included Sinn Féin and within the Gays and Against Imperialism movement. To quote Brendan Fay, human rights activist and filmmaker, while the early 1980s was a time when most young Irish gay men and lesbians remained silent and invisible, Tarlach was an active leader. Along with his good friends, Fergus O'Hare, Cathal Corrigan and Marie Mulholland of Lesbian and Gays Against Imperialism, he was out loud and proud, making connections between movements for LGBT equality and for national liberation. He participated in forums and marches and wrote letters challenging the all too common prejudice, inequality and violence faced by gay youth. In the early 1980s, Tarlach enjoyed his university life at the New University of Ulster. He became a strong, articulate voice within the Students' Union on LGBT and nationalist issues. In 1983, the National Union of Students Lesbian and Gay Conference was held in Queen's University, Belfast. This was a volatile time in Northern Ireland. The conflict was at its height, and the conference was taking place 2 years after the 1981 hunger strikes, in which 10 men died, and only 1 year after the decriminalisation of homosexuality in Northern Ireland. The events of that weekend mark a remarkable chapter in Belfast LGBT history. The Reverend Ian Paisley's Democratic Unionist Party led a Save Ulster from Sodomy crusade onto the steps of the Students' Union at Queen's University, Belfast. This iconic photo shows Tarlach in full flow. His t-shirt reads, "Save Sodomy from Ulster," as he raises his clenched fist in irony and defiance against the DUP campaign. The tension mounted, and the National Union of Students delegates were in danger of actual physical harm. Phone calls were made, and a fleet of the famous Black Taxi, the Free Taxi Association, was dispatched to bring the delegates, including a young Jeff Evans, who is now Dr. Jeff Evans, one of the committee members of the Outing the Past Festival, to safety in the Marty Forsythe Social Club in Turf Lodge, a staunch nationalist area in West Belfast. This resulted in one of the most inclusive and welcoming LGBT events the students' delegates had ever encountered. That weekend inspired a 2019 Caboose Theatre production, A Queer Ceili at the Marty Forsythe, by playwright Dominic Montague. Tarlach travelled home from New York for a post-production panel with his good friend, the aforementioned Dr. Jeff Evans. The iconic image of Tarlach wearing the Sea of Sodomy from Ulster t-shirt was used to promote this event. It will also be used to promote the Queering the North exhibition, which includes Tarlach's archives of LGBT activism and history. These archives are currently held by the Free Derry Museum. In 1983, Tarlach moved to New York City and quickly got involved in LGBT and Irish activism. The following audio clip is part of an interview held with him in 1984.
Our organisation had its origins in the hunger strike campaign, when a group of lesbians and gay men from Dublin, Belfast and Cork, all of whom had been involved as individuals in the anti-imperialist movement for a number of years, came together to form Lesbians and Gays Against Hate Bloc Armagh. Towards the end of the hunger strike campaign, we broadened our activities, and the name of our organisation was changed to Irish Lesbians and Gays Against Imperialism. One of the reasons why we united together was to demand that the anti-imperialist movement and its constituent organisations, that is, Sinn Féin, the IRSP, People's Democracy, etc., recognise the specific oppression we face because of our sexuality, and that they defend our rights when they come under attack. This involves publicising a number of issues: the police repression directed against lesbians and gay men, the institutionalised discrimination directed against us by the state, the discrimination practised against us by employers, landlords, bar owners, etc., and the general anti-gay prejudice which is endemic in Irish society, which results in us becoming the victims of considerable physical violence. We are all socialists, committed to fighting for the end of British rule in Ireland and the establishment of a united socialist country. However, we're all too well aware of the oppression of gay people in other countries which have had socialist revolutions, for example, Cuba and China. And we see our fight for socialism as being meaningless unless it also includes a fight for lesbian and gay liberation. After all, this revolution is our revolution too. Just as the issues surrounding the oppression of women were largely ignored by the anti-imperialist movement until women involved in the movement demanded that these issues be taken on board, so we believe that the issue of our oppression will be ignored unless we demand that it's put in the agenda.
When the Irish Lesbian and Gay Organisation, ILGO, formed, Tarlach became an uncompromising and articulate spokesperson for this organisation. He thrived in such environments. He was warm, open and intelligent. He was both principled and fierce when it came to equality and human rights issues. When the Irish author Malky McCourt, he joined the first USA TV debate, which included the right for LGBT people to walk in the New York St. Patrick's Day parade. In March 1993, along with many others, including Brendan Fay, Tarlach was arrested for protesting at the St. Patrick's Day parade. As Brendan Fay states, "How Tarlach could sing. With songs and ballads, he would keep our spirits up. For Irish LGBTQ inclusion in the St. Patrick's Day parade, for immigration rights, marriage equality, and disability rights." Tarlach was honoured in 1997 with the Lavender and Green Roger Casement and Eva Gore Booth Leadership Award. He was cited for both his LGBTQ activism and his dedication to New Yorkers living with disabilities. After a 25-year struggle, the Lavender and Green Alliance was finally invited to march in the 2016 St. Patrick's Day Parade in New York City. Tarlach was one of the main organisers and was called to use all his negotiation and conciliation skills to bring the Irish LGBTQ groups together for this historic march. My wife Patricia and I travelled to New York to be with him on this momentous occasion. We will never forget the cheer as, linking arms, we walked onto Fifth Avenue, joined by many significant characters, including the mayor of New York, Bill de Blasio, and his wife, the Irish author Colin McCann, Malky McCourt, the Irish actor, writer and politician, Loretta Glutzman, chair of the American Ireland Fund, Mary Lou MacDonald, now president of Sinn Féin, Brendan Fay, human rights activist and filmmaker, Kathleen Walsh Darcy, co-chair of the St. Pat's for All Parade in New York, and Edie Windsor, hero of equal marriage rights in the USA. Such an historic moment for all, especially for those who had fought and protested for 25 years. During that parade, Tarlach stood out. He was immensely proud, staunchly solid, and unbelievably strong. This was recognised by the New York St. Patrick's Day Parade Formation Committee, who invited him to join them the following year. During his 30 years in New York, Tarlach never forgot his home. His heart remained in Belfast. He returned home as often as he could, and his New York door was always open with a huge Tarlach welcome. He was so proud of the changes in Belfast, encapsulated by the positivity around pride. He spoke often of the cold, friendless early days when a little more than 100 people marched, and they were often outnumbered and jeered and abused by protesters. He returned home for Pride in 2017, and this proved to be a momentous occasion for him, with more than 60 of his extended family, young and old, joining him at that parade. It was a beautiful sight for him to relish and enjoy, including a visit to his local bar, where almost 40 years previously he had been barred for kissing another gay man. The bar was now decorated with rainbow flags, and he was welcomed in with open arms. He was rightly proud of the role he and others had played in the struggle that brought LGBTQ equality to the north of Ireland. Tarlach died on the 1st of April 2020 in a New York hospital of complications arising from COVID-19. One of the many tributes paid to him in Ireland and the USA, this podcast from Hidden Histories by Donald Fallon captures some of what I have included in my presentation.
And then this great story, Tarlach MacNiallais, a name that's more widely known, I think, in New York City than in his native Belfast or Ireland more broadly. But, you know, an enormous man, literally and in terms of spirit, taken long before his time.
Very long before his time, because he wasn't yet even 60, but his life had seen so much.
When I was reading into what he had done in his lifetime, I mean, it's incredible to think he was 57 years of age. Mm. And that is a reminder just how much has changed very quickly, not only here in Ireland, but indeed on the other side of the Atlantic as well. And he was someone who had a really sharp sense of history. He'd only just donated his own archive and papers to a museum in the north, an incredible archive, really, which captures the kind of rich tapestry of LGBT history in Northern Ireland. So, you know, it seems fitting this morning to talk a little bit about him and his times, because I think in a way what it allows us to do by putting a name on just one of these ever-increasing numbers, you know, it humanises this awful tragedy in its own way.
Absolutely. So tell us a little bit then about Tarlach's story, because he came of age in the cauldron of 1980s Belfast, and particularly that campaign run by Ian Paisley, Save Ulster from Sodomy.
He was a student of Queen's University Belfast at a time when politics in Northern Ireland really happened in one place, and that was on the streets. And the social battle lines were, even amidst the political chaos, I mean, there were social battle lines. Mm. And in the late 70s, the Reverend Ian Paisley and the Democratic Unionist Party launched what was called the Save Ulster from Sodomy campaign. And Ian Paisley, you know, in a classical kind of sense, he was a street preacher. And it's worth saying this, Paisley died a very different man to the Paisley of the 1980s in many ways. I mean, absolutely. He made peace with many people, and he became a kind of broadly liked figure in Irish society. But in the 80s, he was a different man. And he was someone who kind of, he understood shock politics, street politics. And actually, if you look at the kind of Westboro Baptist Church in America,
there was
some of that off Ian Paisley. You know, he would show up outside of an event with a banner which was designed to provoke people, or he would interrupt speakers, most famously the Pope. But the Save Ulster from Sodomy campaign was remarkable. 70,000 people. And that banner literally hung across buildings in Belfast city centre, Save Ulster from Sodomy. And as a young student, Tarlach MacNiallais was involved in a campaign against this. They inverted the message of Paisley brilliantly on a mock T-shirt that became really, really iconic. Save Ulster from Sodomy became Save Sodomy from Ulster, to the horror of the Reverend. And there were pitched battles, literally and metaphorically, on the campus at Queen's. But for me, that T-shirt, Save Sodomy from Ulster, I mean, it's just this great moment of humour at a time when there was very little humour in Northern Ireland. And I always place it on par with the famous Belfast street graffiti that said, you know, no topless sunbathing, Ulster has suffered enough.
It's always amazing how humour can just sort of show up in the most darker places. It's phenomenal. So that was then the slogan that basically he completely just turned the campaign on its head.
Absolutely.
To the fury of Paisley and the others.
And he recognised something, Tarlach, as a young man, that a lot of people recognised in Belfast. I mean, you had this weird situation where you lived in a British jurisdiction, you used British money, there was a British flag over City Hall, and yet local government didn't implement British laws that they didn't like in Northern Ireland. So, I mean, it was a kind of a la carte Britishness that, you know, young activists like him regarded very much as totally and completely hypocritical.
Which I suppose is a similar argument that's been made in more recent years as well, with the lack of same-sex marriage and abortion rights that have only recently been amended in Northern Ireland. The people think that there's still a certain amount of a la carte Britishness going on there. Tell us then about his emigration to New York City then, where things get really tough.
The Northern Ireland that he left was a bit of a cold house for gay people. Things changed very, very slowly. I mean, there was the first gay pride parade in 1991 through the streets of Belfast. About 120 people marched from Ulster University to Botanic Gardens. And it was people like him really that paved the way and allowed that to happen. But he went to New York City, the traditional kind of bastion of young Irish migrants, and threw himself into what was called the ILGO, the Irish Lesbian and Gay Organisation, which was a total thorn in the side of kind of official Irish America and what they called Hibernianism. They would picket the Patrick's Day parade. A few weeks ago, we did a slot actually on the New York St. Patrick's Day parade, and they were banned from marching in it. But it was in many ways as physically dangerous to be campaigning for gay rights in New York City as it was to be doing it in Belfast. And there's a lovely autobiography. This might be the greatest title for an autobiography ever published by Kelly Cogswell, an activist in New York, called Eating Fire, My Life as a Lesbian Avenger. There's a name for a book. She talks about just the abuse that people like her and Tarlach got. She says, you'd be standing at the side of the parade and they'd be shouting, you have your own parade, this is our parade, not yours. And that's about the only insulting quote you could read on the radio. Mm. But there's a really remarkable passage in her memoir. She says, in the time I hung out with the ILGO, this big guy Tarlach got beaten to within an inch of his life. Little Brendan Fay lost his job teaching religion at a Catholic high school when he marched with us for the first time. Later on in 93, Brendan was stabbed when he was walking home in Brooklyn, the blood from a punctured lung spilling out over the sidewalk. I mean, that is the New York City of the 1990s, which is
This is my tribute to an immense man, a husband, a brother, an uncle, and a friend. As an activist for justice and equality, he was principled, warm, and intelligent. As Brian Patton's poem, So Many Different Lengths of Time, states, a man lives for as long as we carry him inside us, for as long as we carry the harvest of his dreams, for as long as we ourselves live, holding memories in common, a man lives. We do hold those common memories of Tarlach. His legacy will live on as long as we do. Those who live in the hearts of others will never die. Tarlach is survived by his husband, Juan. This is a photo of the both of them in happier times. I will finish with one of Tarlach's favorite songs and a selection of photos celebrating his life.
Imagine all the people You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us and the world will be as one. Imagine no possession. I wonder if we can. No need for greed or hunger. A brotherhood and sisterhood of man. Imagine
conclude, I would like to thank some people who supported me throughout. A special thanks to my wife, Patricia, for her media expertise and her critical wisdom. For Dr. Jeff Evans for his advice and guidance in putting this together. Through this process, we have strengthened our friendship. To the Irish radio station News Talk for making the Hidden Histories podcast available. To Richard O'Leary for helping me to structure my thoughts at the beginning of the process and for helping take the mystique out of it. Finally, I would like to thank all my family and friends for their photos, images, and contributions and moral support. Ardesh Guru Ega Anam Tarlach, rest in peace.
Welcome to Kilmainham Jail Museum in Dublin in Ireland. It's great to be taking part in the New York Out in the Past Festival 2021. Sorry, I can't be there with you in person. We're still in lockdown here in Ireland. The museum is currently closed to the public, so it's great to be able to be sharing these stories of the history of Kilmainham Jail in particular, the queer history of Kilmainham Jail. My talk today is going to look, I suppose, in general at that history, but in particular as well at the work that we've done exploring the historical collection in the museum for evidence of the lives of LGBTQIA plus people. So I'm going to start sharing my screen now. So, as I said, my name is Brian Crowley. I'm the curator of collections here in Kilmainham Jail Museum. Some of you may be familiar with the jail. It's quite an iconic building in terms of Irish history. Some of you may even have visited if you've been over to Dublin at some point. We're one of the biggest visitor attractions in the city. But as I said, today we're talking exclusively about the queer history of Kilmainham Jail. So I said this is the front of the jail. The jail was built in 1796. It was built as the county jail for Dublin, for County Dublin. And it operated as a criminal prison up until 1910. So among the various prisoners that would have been in the jail, you would have had primarily men who would have been here for same-sex activity. So, as I said, this is kind of images of the jail when it was a working prison. It's quite an extensive building, just at the edge of the city centre. As I said, it was built in 1796, but a good proportion of it is very much a kind of a Victorian prison, a very kind of typical Victorian prison in terms of the technology and architecture involved. But it's most famous because of its associations with the struggle for Irish independence. And I think principally because it was in Kilmainham Jail that the leaders of the 1916 Rising were executed in May of 1916. So in some ways, the jail is kind of transformed from being a place of punishment into, I suppose, a kind of a secular Republican shrine. And when President Eamon de Valera, who was a former prisoner here in Kilmainham Jail following the 1916 Rising and again during the Irish Civil War, when he opened the jail on the 50th anniversary of the 1916 Rising in 1966, he said, "This is then a hallowed place. It will inspire our people to preserve the nation and encourage them to exalt it among the nations of the earth as the men of 1916 wanted it." So you can see here that this is, a building that is in some ways more than just a historic site. It's a building that almost has a almost quasi-religious significance in terms of Irish identity. You know, the words like hallowed, sacred, holy are constantly used about the building once it becomes a museum. So it continues in this role. So this is an image of our current president, President Michael D. Higgins, in 2016 at the ceremonies to mark the centenary of the 1916 Rising. And as I said, it does perform that function within kind of Irish life as a place in which the struggle for Irish independence and Irish revolutionary history is remembered. It also has associations with all kinds of other revolutionary movements from the 1798 rebellion through to Robert Emmet, the Young Islanders in the 1840s, the Fenians in the 1860s, Parnell in the 1880s. And it was also used as a military prison during the Irish War of Independence and the Irish Civil War. So it has, you know, incredible resonance with Irish history, and in some ways the story of Irish revolutionary history can be told through the history of this building. So I suppose within that context then, exploring the queer history, the LGBT history of this building has an extra resonance. The idea that at the heart of this building, so bound up with Irish identity, that you also have queer stories, is something that has proved to be, I think, really significant, certainly for the LGBTQIA community here in Ireland. So this is an image of some people taking part in one of the queer history tours. Here you can see alongside the tricolour outside Kilmainham Jail Courthouse, which is now part of the museum complex. We have the rainbow flag flying for Pride. And again, that's a really big moment in terms of the history of Kilmainham as a museum. It was really, actually for me, actually near quite an emotional moment the morning I arrived in and this flag was flying, because I suppose it's putting these stories in this building, which is, as I said, so significant to so many Irish people. So my initial research into the queer history of the building, a lot of it centered around looking at prison registers. All these registers now have been digitized, and this has been really significant in terms of helping us research the experience of ordinary prisoners in the jail, because essentially what you're often looking for is are crimes like sodomy or buggery, which is a word I don't think widely used in North America, but it is used here in Ireland quite a lot in the past. It had been illegal since the 16th century, essentially, and criminalised. But what I started to notice was that you don't find very many instances of it, because what was criminalised initially is the sexual act, not homosexual identities or homosexual activity per se. Now, this changes with the Labouchere Amendment in 1885, after which time any kind of sexual contact between men becomes criminalised. But again, despite, you know, I suppose the expansion of the legislation to persecute and prosecute gay men, and it's essentially gay men that we're really looking at, that there's no legislation in relation to same-sex activity among women. Despite this, there aren't actually a huge amount of convictions. It's often a very difficult crime to prove. It's usually a crime committed by two people in private. So sometimes what you find is cases where what's happening isn't kind of a consensual act. It's an attack of one person upon another. As in the case of this instance here, these are two young men who were charged with sodomy while serving in the British Navy. In 1903, the HMS Jupiter and the Mediterranean Fleet paid a visit to Dublin, and these two young men, Ernest J. Anson from Hull and Thomas James Lockie from Somersetshire, so they were both English, they were imprisoned in Kilmainham. So presumably maybe the confined situation on board the ship meant it was meant they were more vulnerable to discovery. And in some ways, the fact that they're both English as well would tie in with often a prevailing attitude in Ireland at the time, which was that homosexuality and homosexual acts was something that was somehow foreign and un-Irish and bound up with a kind of a cosmopolitan Britishness. And that's something that kind of certainly survives well beyond independence. But certainly my research would show there were plenty of Irish examples as well. I suppose the reason I'm concentrating on this one is just because there's a bit more information about this story. What I found as well, in many cases, convictions for same-sex activity are considered unfit for publication in newspapers, so they tend to be underreported. So there's great kind of silence around these stories. And I suppose, again, one of the reasons why it was so important for us in Kilmainham to highlight this history was because, ironically, prisons are one of the few places in which these stories are made manifest. In order to punish these men, they had to name the crime within the prison system and the legal system in general. So that's, I suppose, a background to the kind of the general picture in terms of the criminalization of homosexuality in Ireland in the 19th and 20th century. But what I am going to concentrate today is a story that was actually widely publicized at the time, and really, I think, significant in terms of the queer history of Ireland. But I would argue, actually, it's also significant in terms of the UK, given that Ireland was part of the United Kingdom at the time. And it's very much bound up around the events of the 1880s, in particular the land war of the 1880s during that period. And I suppose in some ways influenced by kind of a long running grievance amongst Irish people at the time. At that stage, most of the land of Ireland was owned and operated by
Hello to everyone at the New York Irish Centre and greetings from Tipperary. It's great to be able to speak to you, even if only virtually, today on this topic. How do we write a history of Ireland's LGBTQ plus diaspora? My name is Morris Casey, and I'm the current Department of Foreign Affairs historian in residence at EPIC, the Irish Immigration Museum in Dublin. And tonight, or today, or this evening, or this morning, what my talk is going to be looking at is our forthcoming exhibition here at the museum on the subject of Ireland's LGBTQ plus diaspora. So to give you a quick overview of my talk, it's divided into two parts. The first part, I'm going to introduce you to the exhibition and some of the research methodology, and then I'm going to explore in depth a particular case study, which in fact has its own New York connection. So first, about our forthcoming exhibition. In June this year, June 2021, we will be launching our exhibition here at EPIC, the Irish Immigration Museum, which will also tour to Irish consulates across the world, hopefully, of course, in New York too. The exhibition is titled Out in the World, Ireland's LGBTQ plus diaspora, and it's generously supported by the Irish Department of Foreign Affairs. So over the past few months, I've been researching this topic in depth, and that research has given me a really great appreciation of Ed Madden's insightful suggestion that queer Irish sexuality constituted a diasporic project. It was precisely the capacity of Irish emigrants to transgress borders, whether geographical or societal, that shaped the country into becoming the more progressive and welcoming, though by no means perfect, island which it is today. While literary scholars such as Ed Madden and Tino O'Toole have long made the case for understanding the importance of the Irish abroad to the articulation of Irish LGBTQ plus identity, historians have, I believe, been slower on the uptake to recognize this transnational dimension. There are exceptions, of course. Darrell Leeworthy's recent article on Irish involvement in the LGBT civil rights movement in London makes the case that this was not a coincidental aspect of the 1970s and 1980s, but a potentially rich seam of subjectivity which deserves fuller exploration. Paul Rick Kerrigan, in his work on LGBTQ plus visibility in the Irish media, has also pointed to the importance of diaspora, specifically in the first televised representation of an Irish gay couple to appear on RT in 1979. The report featured Arthur Leahy, who first met Australian-born Laurie Steele in London before both returned to Leahy's native Cork. This pioneering televised portrayal of a gay relationship was thus rooted in the history of emigration. I describe myself as a historian of progressive and radical politics in the 20th century, with a particular focus on Ireland and the Irish abroad. This is the lens and context with which I approach this topic. I feel it important to acknowledge that I am not a member of the LGBTQ plus community, although I am, of course, an ally and someone whose academic work is shaped by an engagement with the field of queer history. In all aspects of my work, I strive to remain sensitive and receptive to my subjective blind spots as a historian whose lived experience differs significantly from that of the people I research. I'm always interested in developing my capacity to empathetically portray the lives and struggles of those communities marginalized in mainstream history and society. In total for this project, I collected roughly 90 different stories that could have been researched in depth to create exhibition panels and whittled these down to a short list of 12. These stories chosen for the exhibition will be divided into six themes: exclusion, community, love, defiance, solidarity, and return. To design the exhibition chronologically, I believed, may have created a false sense of linearity. The six themes are designed to represent significant parts of the LGBTQ plus diaspora experience without suggesting that they encapsulate this experience. I wanted to share with you some stories from themes that will be featured in the exhibition as a kind of teaser that will hopefully encourage you to join us in June. Our first theme, represented here, exclusion, looks particularly at how Irish LGBTQ plus people abroad challenged prejudice in their sites of emigration. In part, this is to challenge an easy narrative about emigration being a straightforward journey from an oppressive island to a liberal wider world. Our exhibition opens with the story of Donegal-born Bridget Call and her Canadian partner, Chris Morrissey. Chris and Bridget, pictured here on the left, met in the 1960s as nuns belonging to the Franciscan missionaries of St. Joseph. After living together in Chile in the 1980s under Pinochet's military dictatorship, Call and Morrissey decided to return to Canada and live openly as a couple. In Canada, they initiated a constitutional challenge against Canadian immigration laws so that Bridget Call, an Irish passport holder, could be legally recognised as Morrissey's partner for the purposes of permanent residency. At the midpoint of the exhibition, under the love theme, attendees will read about the partnership between Peter Doyle, an Irish veteran of the pro-slavery Confederate Army in the US Civil War, and Walt Whitman, who in addition to being a fervent Union supporter, is one of the most celebrated American poets of the 19th century. Towards the end of the exhibition, under the theme of return, we explore a topic that I think deserves both its own exhibition and perhaps a book-length study, HIV/AIDS and the Irish diaspora. It is perhaps impossible to do justice to the story over the course of a single panel, but to tell a human history, I grounded the panel in the story of Robert Rigor, an Irish-American member of the famous activist group ACT UP, who died of an AIDS-related illness in 1994, not long after he visited Ireland alongside his parents for a final time. So that is just three of our stories. And to learn more about them in depth and to learn about our other stories, you're going to have to visit us in June, or indeed an Irish consulate hosting the exhibition. Along the way in the exhibition, we visit such locations as Cambodia, India, Australia, the US and the UK, while covering stories from across the community and the centuries. So let's talk more about where my research has taken me and what lessons for researching the Irish LGBTQ plus diaspora I've learned along the way. I want to share with you the story of what I believe is the most unwittingly queer photograph ever published in the Irish Times in the early 20th century. It's this photograph here, and it portrays a staid and formal reception given by a Miss Kathleen O'Brennan for a Mr. and Mrs. Chester Arthur that took place in 1937 in a Dublin home at 24 South Frederick Street. The occasion was a welcoming reception for a US president's grandson with Irish ancestry and his wife, who was also of Irish extraction. The host of the reception, Kathleen O'Brennan, was an Irish playwright and journalist who had previously spent several years living in the US. The presidential visitor in question was Chester A. Arthur III, who was the grandson of Chester A. Arthur I, a Republican US president whose father hailed from Cullibacky, County Antrim. Mrs. Chester Arthur, as the Irish Times referred to her, was Arthur's wife, Esther Murphy, the granddaughter of famine-era Irish migrants to the US and the daughter of Patrick Murphy, a prominent US businessman involved in the sale of luxury leather goods. The couple were precisely the kind of well-to-do Irish Americans with familial ties to wealth and politics that the powerful and the newly independent Irish Free States were anxious to court. It should come as no surprise that the respectable Irish Times would devote space on its pages to publicising such an event. Each of these people, Kathleen O'Brennan, Chester Arthur, known to many as Gavin Arthur, and Esther Murphy, fit easily into the history of Ireland's diaspora. O'Brennan as a former migrant, Murphy is a second generation Irish American, and Arthur is someone with yet more distant Ulster Scots ancestry. But what place do they have in a history of Ireland's LGBTQ plus diaspora? To answer this question, we must turn back our clocks to trace the interweaving transatlantic journeys of our three protagonists to 24 South Frederick Street in May 1937, starting with Kathleen O'Brennan. Kathleen O'Brennan, born in 1876 in Dublin, was a well-known figure in Irish dramatic and Republican circles. She was also the sister of Áine O'Brennan, who married Éamon Ceant, the Irish rebel executed in 1916 for his role in the Easter Rising. In 1914, Kathleen O'Brennan made her way to the US. Her activities in the US, which included writing radical politics and agitation for the Irish cause, have been tracked by the historian Catherine M. Burns. She was one of a number of Irish women, including Hannah Shee Skeffington and Muriel McSweeney, who took part in these drives across the US to generate American and Irish-American support for the Irish nationalist cause. In Portland, Oregon, during these years, O'Brien met Marie Equi, an Irish-Italian radical known both for her assertive advocacy for labor rights and women's access to reproductive care, in addition to her conscious self-description of herself as a lesbian. Michael Hellquist, a biographer of Equi, notes that Equi fell in love with O'Brien, a woman she called My Little Rebel. At the same time that Equi and O'Brien were organizing together, they were being reported on by an informant assigned by US authorities to keep tabs on both women. Hellquist writes further that the agents trailing them, an agent William Byron, received reports of O'Brien and Equi's goings-on in late 1918 that were, quote, too lascivious to be recorded. This source is a reminder of how, unfortunately, historians of LGBTQ plus sexual identity in the early 20th century must rely on the evidence of those who were invested in cataloguing what they deemed deviant activities. Yet even police records and medical assessments, when read by historians in an empathetic way, can be used as evidence not just of repression and surveillance, but also of individual agency. Sometime during her activism in the US, O'Brien also met an Irish-born artist by the name of John O'Shea, a respected painter who included among his own social networks the Irish-American presidential family, the Arthurs. In 1921, as O'Brien's time in the West Coast was coming to a close, on the other side of the US, Chester A. Arthur III was also preparing to set off for Ireland. In late 1921, when Ireland was a country on the brink of civil war, this young American stepped off a boat at Cove and devoted himself to an ultimately failed attempt to help usher in a national spiritual and sexual revolution in his ancestral home. On the day of his arrival in Ireland, Chester Arthur III walked to Cork, speaking with all of the newly negotiated Anglo-Irish treaty and finding the Irish people engaged and interested. In Killarney, he met Donal O'Cahill, a well-known local activist who was a commandant in the IRA. Arthur camped with IRA volunteers on Inishfallen Island, and over the course of a month fully embraced his ancestral Irish identity and Irish republicanism. When Arthur arrived in London, an Irish delegation was in London, negotiating what shape Ireland's independence would take. As Arthur walked through Ireland, the country at large was settling into two camps, Republican and Treatyite, which would eventually constitute the belligerent sides in the Civil War that took place after the foundation of the Irish Free State and lasted from June 1922 to May 1923. Arthur was assertively anti-treaty. From Kerry, Arthur made his way to Dublin, where he would rely on his networks to link him into the Irish Republican equivalent of his American social circles. Through his painter friend John O'Shea, he was introduced to Kathleen O'Brien, who, by March 1922, was once more residing in Dublin. Reading the memoir of Ella Young, an Irish Republican and mystic, I came across a passage that described the welcoming party held for Arthur in O'Brien's home. Ella Young wrote, "I always like to visit Kathleen O'Brien's rooms. This afternoon, she's giving a reception in honor of a handsome young American, Chester Alan Arthur, grandson of President Arthur, who has come to this country mindful that it cradled his ancestors and found relatives in County Antrim. He wants to draw up his whole career and work for Ireland. Some of us tried to dissuade him. We know what work for Ireland means." It was the beginning of almost 4 years that Arthur would spend in Dublin with his first wife, Charlotte Wilson, during which time he also had a brief affair with the socialist and poet Edward Carpenter, pictured here on the left, who in turn introduced him to two other luminaries of research into human sexuality, Havelock Ellis and Magnus Hirschfeld. During the 1920s, Arthur also developed his own theory of human sexuality that he described as the circle of sex, which used astrology to outline a diversity of human sexuality. What interests me about Arthur is the question of what it means for our understanding of the kinds of ideas that were discussed within the Dublin radical elite of the 1920s, given that someone enmeshed within this network could be simultaneously in contact with these three pioneering figures of what was then termed sexology. As O'Brien and Arthur supported the Irish Republicans in 1920s Dublin, Esther Murphy, the woman who would eventually become Arthur's wife, was living the life of a lesbian socialized in interwar Europe. Esther was born 1897 in New York, the daughter of Patrick Francis Murphy and Anna Elizabeth Ryan. Both of Esther's parents were themselves the American-born children of famine-era Irish migrants. Patrick Murphy, Esther's father, was the owner of the prestigious Mark Cross leather goods brand. His success granted his children an upbringing of enormous privilege. The Murphy family were a case study in how the famine-era Irish migrant could transcend their situation in America over the course of a generation. Esther Murphy's biographer, Elisa Cohen, notes that she was 6 feet tall, regal and bearing, yet irremediably awkward. She was all energy, compulsion and excitement about ideas, and she was excited above all about the past. Murphy was by career a historian, although she had a perpetual habit of never finishing her projects. Her search for an acceptable society took her through New York elite cultural life and beyond, including the lesbian counterculture of 1920s Paris, where she became an associate of other sexually dissident women, including Gertrude Stein, Janet Flanner, and Dorothy Wilde, niece of Oscar. During this time, Murphy was romantically enchanted by the poet Natalie Barney, lover of Dorothy Wilde. Dorothy, known to friends and lovers as Dolly, once wrote to Natalie Barney asking whether or not she had yet made listless love to Esther. Moving through these sapphic circles in New York and Paris, Esther Murphy found other women with whom she shared cultural tastes and an openness about their own desires. Murphy first married John Strachey, the British Labour MP, in 1929. They were an ill-fitting couple. Although they had in common their status as the politically articulate children of wealthy parents, Murphy found herself adrift in the misogynistic culture of the English political elite. Strachey and Murphy divorced after only a few years of marriage, although they retained a mutual admiration for each other's intellectual gifts. In 1934, she would meet the man who would become her second husband, Chester Arthur, whom she met through their mutual involvement in leftist politics and support for Franklin Delano Roosevelt's New Deal. The circles that Arthur and Murphy hosted in their homes included such luminaries as the African-American poet Langston Hughes and the prominent leftist writer Ella Winter. Bound by a shared investment in Democratic Party politics of the New Deal era, Arthur and Murphy admired and had personal meetings with Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt. It should be noted that the portrait of Chester Arthur that emerges from Lisa Cohen's account of his marriage to Esther Murphy reveals Arthur to have been a deeply flawed partner. Although Cohen notes that initially Murphy enjoyed being the focus of Arthur's attention and was reassured by his open bisexuality, the relationship was deteriorating by the 1940s. And so, having learned of how Kathleen O'Brien found her way back to Ireland and how Arthur and Murphy found each other, here we arrive in May 1937, back at our gathering at 24 South Frederick Street. Queer history as a field is partly about upsetting the familiar, of pointing out how dissident identities can be found where we might not expect them. For example, on a photo in a 1937 issue of the Irish Times. Having traced Kathleen O'Brien, Chester Arthur, and Esther Murphy's journey to this reception, we might now see that this is not simply a photograph of a conventional gathering, it is a meeting point of unconventional lives. Behind the photo lies a number of histories, stories of the Irish Civil War, of radical politics in the diaspora, of the Irish-American success story, of US presidential history, and also that subject which I've been tracing these past few months, the history of Ireland's LGBTQ plus diaspora. A story of people who proved tenaciously capable of finding one another. So what does this history tell us about the question in my title? How do we write a history of Ireland's LGBTQ plus diaspora? The primary lesson I took from this research is that the researcher community in the past, you must look beyond the individual stories and reverse engineer personal networks. It is not incidental that our story tonight began with a group photograph, an image of Esther Murphy and Chester Arthur, among others, in the home of Kathleen O'Brien. These people found each other, and once we, as historians and researchers, find them, then they can lead us to new discoveries and less considered corners of the archive where we might uncover LGBTQ plus histories. Reconstructing the social and political networks of O'Brien, Arthur and Murphy allows us to place them not only at a party in May 1937, but at the centre of a transnational early 20th century world that was progressive in both its politics and ideas about sexuality. Secondly, it is possible, though perhaps more difficult, to write about Irish LGBTQ plus identities in the early 20th century without an over-reliance on police records. There are caveats here. Everyone I have discussed, Arthur Murphy and to a lesser extent O'Brien, belong to elite worlds that granted them the possibility to record and be recorded by history in their own voices. It remains more difficult to uncover the voices of the working class participants in the making of modern Ireland, be they LGBTQ plus or otherwise. So thank you finally for watching this presentation. Thank you to those of you who are actively engaged in resurrecting LGBTQ plus histories. If there's anything I can do to help you in your own journeys in outing the past, please do get in touch. You can find me on Twitter at MorrisJCasey or email mjcasey@epicchq.com. Finally, please do, if you get the chance, come along to our exhibition, which will be launching in Dublin in June of this year, and hopefully at an Irish consulate somewhere near you later on. Thank you very much.
To introduce Maggie and Jenny, Maggie is a human rights campaigner who is currently working for Right to Remain, under which she's the organiser for Manchester's These Walls Must Fall. And Jenny was one of PHM's 9 community curators who researched and delivered the museum's award-winning 2017 Never Going Underground exhibition, and often delivers LGBT plus tours at the museum. So I'll hand over to you both to tell us more.
Hi everybody, I'll just share my screen in the presentation now. Let's go. So hopefully now you should be able to see my screen, me and Maggie. So welcome to our virtual tour of People's History Museum. We've selected items from the museum's collection that particularly interest us, and we'll be using them to explore how the themes of migration, race and empire intersect with LGBT plus history and the fight for LGBT plus rights. So I'm going to be looking at some Black gender variant Victorians and issues around imperialism. And Maggie,
Hi everyone. I'm going to be looking at the activism, fighting against LGBT issues, advocacy and self-help support groups that have been set up to support people who are seeking asylum who are LGBT plus.
And just to start with some notes on terminology. So the terms lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, non-binary and queer are all really modern terms. And some historians think that it's absolute heresy to dare describe anyone born before the 20th century as gay or trans, because these labels and identities just didn't exist. But I think that it's fine to say, you know, looking at this historical person's behaviour, nowadays we could see them in the framework of belonging to the LGBT plus community. And it's often interesting how the same historical person or event can be seen in the framework of gay or trans history, or lesbian or trans history. So this, that kind of duality. It's always fantastic to find evidence of historical queer and gender variant lives, and different people will identify with historical figures in different ways. So the first gallery in People's History Museum, so we're just going to be starting on the first floor now, explores the 1800s. And this was a time of immense social change, urbanization, industrialization, the development of new technologies and social movements. And throughout the 1800s, there was a fascination to do with all things impersonation and disguise. In newspapers, you'd often see reviews of high-class fancy dress balls, and there was a real trend for theatre shows with storylines involving sex impersonation. And from the 1840s, American blackface minstrel troupes toured the UK. And these were white people who would apply burnt cork and makeup to their skin and pretend to be black. And soon British performers began using blackface in their shows. And historians argue that back in the day, this fascination with disguised served a purpose at a time of great social change. It was a way of exploring boundaries, about acceptable behaviour, unacceptable behaviour, exploring gender roles, and working through anxieties about different races that Britain experienced through colonisation. In the 1800s, newspapers regularly reported on cases of gender variant people. So people who were assigned female at birth, who lived long term as men, and people assigned male at birth, who passed as female. And here we can see examples of gender variant people who lived in Manchester. A guy called Harry Stokes, who lived in Manchester from the 1820s to the 1850s. And Maria Brown, who lived in Manchester for a short while in the 1850s. So I usually speak about the characters in a real life tour of the People's History Museum. But this is an online tour, and it's also focusing on kind of race and migration. So over the next few slides, I'll be looking at the lives of some black gender variant people who lived in Britain in the 1800s and then the early 1900s. These people that we're going to look at, they were transing gender either temporarily on stage as part of a performance, or more permanently as a result perhaps of their own sense of their gender identity and who they were. With all the people that we're going to look at, we only have small fragments of evidence about these people's lives. And the evidence that does exist was all written by white men and reveals these white men's views and biases and cultural values. And the sources aim to record, these white men are looking at these black people and recording them as exotic and other and different. So that's the main aim in writing about these people. So there's a real lack of the sense of the subject's agency and humanity. They don't tend to have a voice. But if we now try and, in modern day, try and meet these subjects, you know, using empathy, care and compassion, we can get to see their humanity and not just see them as an exotic other. So here we can see items relating to an African-American dancer called William Henry Lane. And he was born in New England in around 1825. He became a dance sensation and is seen as the founding father of tap dancing. William toured the US and Britain as a member of a blackface minstrel troupe. And he was particularly famous for playing a female character called Lucy Long. I mean, a typical minstrel troupe, as we've heard before about the burnt cork and the makeup, would be made up of white men who would be crossing race and gender lines. And minstrel shows typically involve dances and banjo shows appropriating and distorting black culture. Like slaves were portrayed as happy and then content in their lives and really fearful of life outside the confines of the plantation. And this real dehumanizing of Black people can be seen as a way of justifying racism and slavery. So William was unique in being the first Black performer to get top billing over a white performer in a minstrel show. And he performed under the stage name of Juba, which at that time was seen as a typical Black slave name. And the Lucy Long song that he was famous for performing is about a temptress who would dance around the stage, flirting with everybody. And it would normally be a white man who'd be playing this kind of hyper-sexualized Black woman. And we can see an extract of a review here about William performing the Lucy Long the Lucy Long show, and describing the appearance of William. So a bewitching bonnet and veil, and wearing a very pink dress, beflounced to the waist. So, I mean, there were, like I say, about people not having voices and evidence in the archives, apart from that written by white men. So there's a lot of unanswered questions about how William felt about being the only Black guy in a troupe of white minstrels. Was he accepted as one of the troupe or treated as an outsider? And how did he feel about performing these stereotypes of African-American people? So, and now we'll move on to 1850, when newspapers reported on the trial of Eliza Scott, who had been accused of attempted sodomy. So Eliza was a sex worker who was based in and around the Fenchurch Street area of London. And one night, Eliza and a fella who was up for a bit of business went off together to a secluded place. However, when Eliza lifted her veil, the bloke took offence, first to the fact that she was a person of colour, but also he saw that she had some facial hair growth. He ran off to fetch a policeman. He actually had to approach two policemen because the first one he approached wasn't interested in anything to do with what was going on. So this second policeman came and approached Eliza and accused her of being a man. And she denied it. And she's saying that she was the mother of two children. And when the policeman tried to arrest her, she hit out and there was a struggle and she was forced to go to the police station. And newspapers told of how Eliza was examined at the station and his sex was placed beyond doubt. In court, Eliza explained that she was a runaway slave who had been living in New York, making her living by cleaning, washing and ironing and looking after people who were ill. She had a real talent for helping people with rheumatism and she used massage and Indian herbs. So a ship's captain got to learn about her healing skills and he asked her to join him on a crossing to England to nurse his aches and pains. He promised that he'd get her back to America safely. However, he abandoned her in London and she had been here for the last 6 months. So newspaper reports describe her as feminine with an effeminate voice and long hair parted down the middle. So always with newspaper reports about gender variant people, there's a lot of focus on their appearance and how different elements of their looks might give away that their true gender, etc. And at the court case, the policeman said he'd often seen Eliza walking the streets, approaching men, but he'd always considered her to be a woman and part of the community of Black sex workers who worked in that area. So during the trial, Eliza was found guilty, not of attempted sodomy, but of common assault for attacking the policeman. And she was sentenced to 12 months in prison. In 1879, Britain's disastrous war with the Zulu people came to an end, and a craze for all things Zulu developed. The British public were keen to see those fierce warrior savages that they had read about in the papers. A number of Zulu people were contracted to tour Britain. They were basically exhibits to be stared at. They were often billed as members of the Zulu royal family. Come and see the king's daughters. Come and look at this medicine man. And a review of one show talks about how at the show a Zulu baby was passed around the audience members, which is just so horrifically dehumanising. And there were lots of articles in the press about how unhappy the Zulu performers were, and they were complaining about how they weren't being paid, about how they were being swapped between white managers, and how they were sick of being exploited. In 1880, here we can see about how newspapers reported on a guy called John Thomas Williams. And he was a black British guy who had been passing himself off as a Zulu queen called Ungami Wala. John may well have been thinking, you white Britons are like appropriating black culture, you're exoticizing these people, you're such fools. So I'm just going to make the most of this. I'm going to pass myself off as a Zulu, even though I'm not, and I'm just going to make money off this craze. And in the spring of 1880, John arrived in Chesterfield with as part of a group of Zulus who were exhibiting themselves at 2 pence a head entrance fee. The landlord of a local pub, which also served as a brothel, offered him a job as a barmaid. John worked at the pub for a number of weeks, but he was then arrested for stealing £14 from the landlord. And the landlord also complained to the police that Ungami was really a man. At the court case, there was a discussion about whether the pub manager knew that John was a man all along. The landlord denied it, but John said, of course you knew, I dressed as a man working, you know, with you for the first week that I was working with you. John didn't deny that he'd stolen any money. He told the court that the landlord kept me for deceiving the public, and now I've deceived him. The magistrate, rather randomly, told John that he would be treated with leniency, like the English always do with foreigners. I don't know where he got that idea from. John was sentenced to 3 months hard labour. And a couple of weeks later, the landlord was later charged and convicted for keeping a brothel. The picture we can see here dates from 1905. So Paul Downing, also known as Caroline Brogdon, was an African-American person from Georgia who lived in England for several years. They were assigned female at birth, but lived as a man. Paul had worked as a sailor, a farm labourer, and also as an odd job man for an undertaker. In 1905, Paul was found running after buses on Blackfriars Bridge, looking for his wife. He was arrested and sent from the police station to the male ward at Bow Hospital, where it was subsequently found that they were assigned female at birth. They were deemed to be a vagrant lunatic and they were sent off to the City of London Asylum, where unfortunately they died within the year. And this rather amazing photo was included as part of a research project by cultural geographer Dr. Caroline Bressy, who was exploring the multicultural nature of the City of London Asylum Archive. And Dr. Bressy highlights that other people whose photos were taken at asylums tended to hide from the cameras or look away. However, Caroline Brogdon's defiant stare challenges our right to judge her or even to know her. In the next few slides, I'll look at how same-sex desire and gender variance were seen as something that was very un-English. Traditionally, lesbian sex has been ignored by the law in Britain. Basically, women were so under the thumb and their lives were controlled in so many other ways. There was no reason to explicitly outlaw lesbianism. There was also a strategy of denial and suppression of information about lesbian sex. Basically, bigwigs thought, you know, women in Britain would never think lesbian sex existed unless they were specifically told about it. And a court case from 1811 shows how the denial of sex between women in Britain had a real racial element. So two schoolmistresses, Jane Pirrie and Marianne Woods, sued for libel after they were accused by teenage pupils of being in a sexual relationship. But those rumours led to pupils being removed from their boarding school and the school actually having to close down. So the teacher sued the guardian of a teenager called Jane Cumming, who had been the main accuser of those teachers. Jane had a white British father, but an Indian mother. And when her father died, she was brought over to England to be with her grandmother, Lady Cumming Gordon. At the libel trial, there were explicit descriptions of what the two teachers had been up to in bed, because basically the pupils shared a room with them. But the judges, they didn't want to believe that sex acts between women ever took place in England. The judges really focused on Jane Cumming's Indian heritage. They claim that she must have learnt about such practices back in Hindustan from Hindu laws and Indian nursemaids. One judge stated, "They import the crime of one woman giving another the clitoris, which in this country is impossible to commit. However well known the crime charged here, maybe among Eastern nations, this is the first instance on record of such an accusation having been made in this country." In the 1800s, Britain exploited and dominated other cultures. And this poster from which says, "From the colonies to the colonies," is illustrating a vision of imperial trade and the transport of goods back and forth across the globe. And Britain was also responsible for another export, the export of homophobic laws to the Indian subcontinent, to Asia, and to sub-Saharan Africa. Britain introduced the first anti-sodomy law in 1860 in India, and over the following 40 years, laws criminalising unnatural offences were imposed across British colonies. And these laws didn't reflect the values of the cultures they were imposed on. There was no consultation with the people living there. You know, British governors didn't go, you know, "How do you feel about this law? Do you think it's needed?" Rather, our British ancestors just thought of it as a civilising mission. You know, they were thinking, oh, these natives, they lack morals, their women have no modesty. The men go around dressing in women's clothes. We need to impose some order on all this debauchery. So there is a lot of evidence of same-sex activity and acceptance of gender-variant people in the cultures that Britain colonised. And British colonial governors had to design special laws just to stamp out behaviour that they saw that they considered undesirable. Laws introduced in Sudan and northern Nigeria outlawed a category of vagrant known as a catamite, which was any male person who dresses or is attired in the fashion of a woman in a public place and who practices sodomy as a means of livelihood. In 1897, Britain introduced a law in India called an Act for the Registration of Criminal Tribes and Eunuchs. And this was specifically introduced to outlaw hijras. These were people who were assigned male at birth, but lived their lives as female or third gender. Fortunately, the hijra community prevailed, and in modern day India, as in the past, they have a very well-defined and permitted social role within the community there. In the 1880s and 1890s, King Mwanga ruled Buganda, which is now part of modern day Uganda. And in today's terminology, he could be described as bisexual. He had 16 wives, but also a harem of men. He did everything he could to stop Britain occupying his lands and imposing their Christian beliefs. He expelled missionaries, he assassinated an archbishop, and he forced Christian converts to abandon their new faith or face death. He's particularly remembered for murdering Christians who were trying to rescue men from his harem. He also had a number of men killed when they refused to sleep with him after being influenced by Christian missionaries. Imperialism didn't just lead to Britain imposing its values overseas, it also had a massive impact on cultural attitudes within Britain itself. So there were a lot of anxieties over having fit and healthy men to defend and maintain the empire. And this influenced ideas about gender and sexuality towards the end of the 1800s and the beginning of the 1900s. So at the end of the 1800s, the British Empire was at its height. It included 345 million people and covered 11.5 million square miles. There was absolutely no way that men on the ground could police all of this area. So it was really important to promote a sense of English superiority to keep the natives in check. And this led to the promotion of very clear gender roles. We needed strong, courageous men ready to defend the empire. And a woman's role was to be mother of the race, breeding fit and healthy specimens. But gay sex scandals at this time led to concerns about how a class of effeminate elites were contaminating the nation's morals. And this led to a crackdown on deviant sexuality. Here we can see a picture of Bolton and Park, who were two upper middle class gender variant Victorians. In 1870, they were charged with conspiracy to commit sodomy, and they were rumoured to be involved with MP Lord Arthur Clinton, also seen pictured. And after a long drawn out trial, they were eventually found not guilty due to a lack of evidence. But this case was a factor in the tightening of anti-gay laws in 1885. So before 1885, you could only be prosecuted for sodomy or attempted sodomy. But after this law change in 1885, you could be prosecuted for a whole range of behaviour and touching. and there were real fears about having enough healthy men to defend the empire. In 1899, the majority of men trying to enlist at army recruiting stations in Manchester were rejected because they were physically unfit. So leaders were saying, oh my God, how are we going to defend our empire when the working classes are so, you know, weak and physically unfit? And during the late 1800s, women started to challenge traditional gender roles and demand political, educational and employment rights. So the states countered this, and they began to promote the role as woman, as mother, reminding women that it was their duty in life to marry and to breed healthy children to defend the British race. We can see this ideal illustrated in a statue called Motherhood, which was erected in Manchester in 1901. So it's in Piccadilly Garden, it's just behind that statue of Queen Victoria. So this statue is really hammering home that a woman at this time is valued for her reproductive capabilities. And so we can see that, you know, in the talk about colonialism and statues, etc., that this statue also fits into that framework. It was built during the height of empire and as a way of promoting motherhood and the defence of the empire. And there was a lot of hostility to women demanding rights and independence. And this postcard dating from 1909 is basically saying, you know, look where we're going to end up if women get rights. There'll be men in dresses and the whole world is going to be turned upside down. And then this newspaper article from 1911 is equating suffragettes and excessive masculinity in women with the extinction of the British race. So this is the last slide from me. It's about homo nationalism versus solidarity. So in 1957, the Wolfenden Committee in Britain recommended that homosexual behaviour between consenting adults in private should no longer be a criminal offence. And then 10 years later, in 1967, gay male sex was partially decriminalised in England and Wales. So the law moved on in Britain, but by this time, the British Empire was pretty much over, and it was too late for anti-gay laws to be amended in the colonies. And then in Britain, since the 1960s, there's been a long and winding road to more gay rights and equality. Whereas over the past few decades, a number of African states have been more vocal in their homophobia. So most African countries which currently criminalise homosexuality do so on the basis of laws that we introduced as British colonisers. But nowadays, homosexuality is promoted as un-African. It's promoted as something Western and an unwelcome import from the West. So we can really see that how cultural values and cultural beliefs are very temporary, contextual, and how they change over time. So who knows what the situation will be in another 100 years in Britain or in countries in Africa. So while African nations use the issue of homosexuality and LGBT rights to portray a certain identity to the world and their values, so do we in the West. We're portraying with, you know, looking at the issue of homosexuality and LGBT rights, we like to say to the world, look how tolerant we are, look how civilized we are, look how superior we are. And this kind of trumpeting about how tolerant we are in the West can blow over into what's known as homo nationalism. And this is the linking of the gay identity and gay rights with nationalism. And kind of taking the view that, you know, in Britain, in the West, we've won equal rights, you know, it's great, we've got equal marriage, everything's fine, but now these rights that we've got are being threatened by these cultures that are coming into our community, you know, these new, these cultures that don't belong here, and they're homophobic and they're threatening us. And so I remember around kind of like the mid-noughties, around 2005-06, when right-wing papers such as the Daily Mail and the Sun started printing articles saying, look at these Muslims, you know, look how they treat gay people, isn't it terrible, it's horrific. But I was thinking, like, hang on, a few years ago, weren't you horrendously anti-gay, horrendously homophobic yourselves? What's going on now? And because now Muslims and immigrants are the outsider within, whereas actually trans people are now the outsider within as well. But so it swaps over time. Gay and lesbian people and bisexual people are not so much the outsider within now for the right-wing press. And then just to finish up, the in complete contrast to homo nationalism is solidarity, and the solidarity that's exhibited by lesbian and gay supports, the migrants. So in the 1980s, lesbian and gay support, the miners, showed real solidarity and raised money for a group of Welsh miners who were on strike. And in return, the unions and then the Labour Party opted to support gay rights. And nowadays, the archive for lesbian and gay support, the miners, is held in the People's History Museum. And today, there's a number of groups that are inspired by the solidarity of lesbians and gay support, the miners, and they're setting up groups to support migrants and to combat Islamophobia, etc. So that they're kind of building on this history of queer solidarity to say, you know, no one's illegal, you know, let's fight for liberation for all. And now I'll hand over to Maggie, who will continue our virtual tour.
Thank you, Jenny. That was very informative. Thank you so much. On my slide, as Jenny has just finished hers, I would love to put it in a way that it's more about teaching and educating people about why asylum seekers or why people leave their homes. You know, if you are in a loving home, you are in a beautiful country that is fair to everyone, why will there be a need for you to leave everyone that you love? And start a journey that you don't know where you are heading, where you don't even know the culture and the language, you know, because most of the times we are being described as if we are here for greed. We are here to waste tax monies, and we are just here to waste on your NHS services and stuff, which is so much untrue. Which is so, so, so untrue. So no one would love to leave their country to come here. When I got here, I got traumatized with the weather. First thing, the weather was so unfriendly. You know, I was like, where am I going? So it's all those things that you need to take into consideration. I know the politicians, they always spoon feed people. They always give you wrong information, but there is one reason why people leave their countries. No matter how poor, where you come from, your home is a home. Your home is a sweet home. No matter what's happening there, it's just your home. That's where you belong. That's all you know. There will be no reason for you to leave your country and just decide you're going wherever you don't know. So as a LGBT, as a refugee myself, I've encountered difficulties and struggles on the journey. I've always said that I've become a voice for the voiceless. I'm speaking on behalf of other asylum seekers on what they encountered. As Jenny said, after her presentation, now it doesn't surprise me that we had to go through all we went through just to prove that you are gay, that you have to prove that you're a lesbian or a bisexual woman. Because when once you get into this country, you have to prove that in front of a judge. You have to say, to give them the reasons to believe you. And if you don't have enough evidence, which means no one is going to believe you, no one is going to take a story, you are going to be refused and you can be detained and deported. So we had some organizations, I'll just name a few in Manchester, that were set up to help people who are seeking asylum. And these organizations, it's not something that they just woke up and decided this is what we're going to do. It's people who didn't know that LGBT asylum seekers going through torture with Home Office, they go through horrible treatment, having to explain themselves, having to prove that they are gays or lesbian or bisexual. And if you approach one person and then they start to talk about it and they'll be like, no, this is not okay. We need to do something about it. So these groups were set up after they had met a few people who were seeking asylum as LGBT plus people. And they saw the need that they need to stand up and do something for these vulnerable people who had left their homes because they were fearing to be persecuted. Then on the banner here, I have the Movement for Justice, which is a grassroots organization. They do direct action to bring about change. They started in the mid 90s after the death of Stephen Lawrence, who was killed in a racist incident. And they campaigned against police brutality, racism, and immigration rights from 2009. During that time, they met a lot of lesbian and gay people who were seeking asylum. And they had to learn about fast track system, people being detained, and their cases were just decided within weeks. And then they would decide, no, you do not deserve to be awarded asylum. So fast track, it's when they just, you go to court today and they refuse your case. And then the next thing, they're planning to send you in a flight to send you back home. So Movement for Justice, they worked with women that they met at Yelswood Immigration Detention Center. And to encourage those women, especially LGBT asylum seekers, to use their voice and their power to stand together and fight the LGBT system that was introduced that time. One thing about asylum seekers is that sometimes you don't know you have rights. You are in fear. You came in this country, you have your own traumatic experience, and then you get here, you don't know that you even have one human right. So Movement for Justice, they had to encourage the asylum seekers, let them know their rights, help them to fight to get out of detention in Yelswood. It is the same with everyone who's seeking asylum, especially women, but with the LGBT people, it's difficult and it's painful. I'm talking about women who have been correctionally raped so that they can prove that, no, you're a woman. Women who have faced genital mutilation, forced abortions, and group rapes and things like that. So they face a lot of things and trauma in their lives, of which to have that kind of a woman and you put the person in detention simply because their cases were fast-tracked. They didn't have enough evidence to prove that they were lesbians or bisexual or gay and things like that, which is really difficult to prove until this day. And then on my left, the LGBT, the UK Lesbian and Gay Immigration Group. They offer legal advice and they also lobby politicians for change. So it is very important, especially to fight for change, because that's where the problem is. And if that can be changed, the way they perceive asylum seekers, they do their cases, it is very important to have those kind of campaigns and fight for those rights. Then on my next slide, is the Lesbian and Immigration Support Group, one of the groups that I'm fully involved with. These are the people that took me as their child and embraced me and gave me comfort. Not only me, many other women that I found there. I think it's 3 years back. So it was after our cases were refused and we were just looking for help and we didn't know where to go. But lucky enough, I was attending Metropolitan Congregation Church in Manchester. And they were like, no, we've heard about wonderful women, British women who are helping vulnerable women like you. So these are their contacts, talk to them and see if they can help you guys in any way. When I got there, our cases had been refused. They had kicked us out of their accommodation because we couldn't provide enough evidence that we are lesbians, that we are bisexual women, and the judge was not having it at all. When we got there, on especially on my first meeting, I was so surprised. I found so many women there. I found about 20-something, I think, from different countries. They were just happy, the atmosphere was lovely, and they were so welcoming. And the volunteers were like, I was like, oh, these are African women, they're just in a white skin, you know? But the sad part is that each and every woman who was there was telling the same story, but in a different way. A woman from Cameroon was telling the same story, how they've been victimized, how they have been raped, how they have left their kids running away, how they have left their homes, leaving their studies. If you meet a woman from Uganda, it was the same thing. So I had to find out like what prompted these women to start this organization. And from my understanding, they said one of the founders was approached by one lady in 2008. She was about to be deported and she was looking for help. She didn't know where to go. And they took her case. They had to find out where they can run around so that they can remove her from detention. And they campaigned for that woman and it was a success. Once she got the success, she started to tell people about the woman who helped her. And then other people started to tell other people, and that's when they started to form Lesbian and Immigration Support Group. So it's not only emotional support, but it's also financial support, knowing that we are living in the days of COVID. I know some of our members, they would have loved to be here, you know, but if you don't have data on your phones, what would you do? If you don't have tablets, if you don't have any access to the internet, they wouldn't be here, they can't be here. But with the Lesbian and Immigration Support Group, they had taken it upon themselves that every month they will top up the ladies' phones, they provide grocery vouchers for them to buy food, to make sure they're comfortable and then they can deal with other things. And I would say I'm a proud volunteer now after I was granted my asylum because I felt like there is a lot that needs to be done and I had left many people behind me. I know I found many people, but I left many people as well behind there. So I needed to stand up, help and support them and give them emotional support that I also got. Then on the next slide, this one here was a court that was done by Judge Lord Roger. Like I have explained that the system with the Home Office is not as straightforward as you think. When you're in Africa, when, like Jen said, when we're in Africa, we hear that British, they pride themselves as people who are loving, accommodating, and you know, respecting human rights and stuff. So when you come into this country, you are very hopeful. you are looking forward to a better life. It doesn't matter what one has gone through, but you'll be looking at yourself that, you know what, I'm going to a better place. This is what they have told me about. You watch about pride marches on telly, you would see people living their lives and you would think that is it. And then once you get here, you have to meet the judges, you have to go to court every time and again, you have to tell your story. When telling your story, there is language barrier. In my country, there are some terms that we don't use, that we don't say, especially, I'll give an example, when you're talking about sexual intercourse, you don't say it as it is. So it's about sleeping. You can just say, oh, I was found sleeping with a woman and then they started to beat me, or I was afraid for my life because I was sleeping with a woman. And the judge will simply say, sleeping, you can sleep with anyone. And then you, when you get your refusal, they will tell you that you didn't express yourself. And expressing yourself, it means that you are expressing yourself in front of a man. And we are coming from reserved countries where we respect men, where we don't talk to elders anyhow, where we have to be careful with our language. So you get home and you'll be like, when you're going through your refusal letter, you'll be like, oh my God, I was supposed to have told the judge that actually I was having sexual intercourse or the person was on top of me. The other questions that they were asking, they were like, you need to explain what happened when you were being raped. What did you say? What did they say? No one wants to say those things. No one wants to relive their trauma. Everyone wants to forget that. I'm talking about women who had come here while on the process waiting for their court dates. They're going through counseling with the NHS, that they are worried that we're wasting their money. They're going to counseling. We have connections with Manchester Rape Crisis, trying to let the women forget about what they went through. So after, because the cases, most of the times they delay, they take long. After 1 year, maybe after 6 or 9 months, you've been receiving counseling, you have met lovely people, you have met Manchester people, you have met LISC, a movement for justice, they're giving you hope that things will be different. And then boom, you go to court, they ask you what happened on that fateful day. You're not supposed to leave anything so that the judge can believe you. It doesn't matter whether the judge is female or male. So you have to express yourself. I don't think anyone would want to do that, but because it's a matter of life or death, you know that if I don't do this, then I'll be deported back home, which means I'll be sent back to where I come from. Now you have to go through all these things. Just think about it now, the women are going through lockdown, they're going through COVID, and then you have to worry about these kind of questions that you still have to answer in front of a judge one day when you are going to court. So on this fateful day, when the judge load, at the first time, British were not giving asylum for people who are running away from sexuality. So on that day, he agreed that, okay, no, we need to give these people asylum. But if we agree that the lesbians, the gays, or the bisexual, they can go back to their countries and live discreetly. Or they can move to another city and pretend like they're not. No one wants to do that. No one would ever do that here in UK. They cannot say you're bisexual or you're lesbian. You need now to move to London and pretend you're not, simply because you're scared of your life. So in other ways, they were trying so hard not to give asylum to LGBT plus asylum seekers. Or they were saying you are too feminine to be gay. They would always find something to say on the refusals. Like I'm saying that with LISC, right now people are in the system who are about 32 people. If you get the refusals of each and everyone, you will find undespicable refusal statements that are still being made on this day, 2020 to 2021, that you would not think they're still using those phrases to refuse the claims. And then on my next slide, this one was a poster from 2015 Scottish independence referendum aimed at the LGBT people. What I would say is that there are 270 embassies and consulates around the world campaigning for LGBT human rights. This is what each and everyone would do, because we need to campaign and fight for change, because our African countries, they believe that this homosexual thing it's a Western thing, you know, it's against our culture, it's against their religion and stuff. But, and the embassies and the consulates, they're in there, they're in our countries, they know what is happening. So most of the times I used to wonder that, why is it that Home Office could not write to them and find out that, is this really happening in African, in those countries where you are? Because when they refuse you, they say, oh, we don't believe that, it's safe, maybe in South Africa itself. Yeah, but people are still being killed. It is allowed, but people are still being killed. What are we doing about it? You know, so this was the, this is what I'm saying, that we need to do something. It's up to us. We need to put pressure. We need to campaign and fight for those things. We need to work with the local ground LGBT activists to demand the change and fight for change, especially in African countries, because there's something that is happening there. And they always believe that, oh, if they refuse something or they say they're not accepting homosexuality, which means they are not going to receive aid and stuff. If that has to be like that, it has to be done that way, if that is the way that we have to force the change. Because asylum seekers in this country, they're saying they're wasting money, but the same government in this country is sending money to those homophobic countries that are ill-treating people and are persecuting them. And on my next one, oh yeah. It's quite a journey. Like I'm saying, that if you're in this country, you feel like, okay, even if you're going through asylum, you'll be fighting your cases, but you get introduced to places like Gay Village, Pride, and things like that, where you feel a little bit of a sense of belonging. But the painful thing as well is that we find racism in such places, simply because of our color, from our fellow LGBTI people, that we think they will understand us better. So this poster here, it was in 2019, Manchester Pride, it announced that it was adopting the eight-strap flag to symbolize racial inclusion. So in response, drag queen Peggy Wessex created a Facebook ad for her performance at Bar Pop, showing a unicorn drawing up the black and brown flag stripes. And there were campaigns. People spoke about this. People fight. People wrote to Manchester Pride asking that such people should not be booked for Manchester Pride, but still they did. It was only when they decide that withdrawing from the Pride, but not coming from Manchester Pride. So it's one of those issues that we face, because when you are booking a racist black face, especially for Manchester Pride, it sends a certain message to the mainstream of LGBT. They no wonder why most people, they will still face racism. Not only asylum seekers, not only refugees, but the black and people of color in Manchester, they still face that in this day. Next one. This poster was carried by Rainbow Noir and Manchester Pride 2016. I remember very well, hashtag Black Lives Matter was trending last year. After the US take the knee off my neck, things like that. But Rainbow Noir has been fighting for people of color. Rainbow Noir is a volunteer-led social peer support and community group which celebrates and platforms people of color who identify as LGBT. So they feel like most people who are Black, they're unwelcome, they're objectified or are ignored. And they always find that racism in the gay scenes outweighs homophobia with Black communities. Black men can feel sexualized and used as accessories for white men. There have been a number of campaigns over the past 10 years to try and make the gay scene more inclusive. They have included campaigns to stop blackface acts, like I've said earlier, being booked for pride events. And then in 2013, LGBT people of Manchester, people of color in Manchester, launched a petition to pull out a racist performance from the main stage at Pride. The performers were drag queens of pop. They had just released a controversial YouTube with a blackface minstrel parody of Will.i.am and Black Eyed Peas. Manchester Pride didn't remove them off the line, but the performers had to remove themselves and cancel in response of the controversy. The then Manchester Pride chief, they released a statement basically belittling queer people of color's concerns about the act of being racist. And because Facebook will be always full of gay white fans, they were attending the act and we were outlined as well. So these are the things that we still face as Black LGBT plus people. Racism, we feel unwelcome, and forgetting that these people that are fighting their own cases. That's why most of the times my heart breaks, because on that fateful day, you'll be feeling like, you know, I've managed to take myself out today with friends. I've managed to leave the house after depression and stuff, only to get out there and be treated in some way. Then my last post. This was me in one of the Manchester Pride. I always feel like I believe in the statement that says Pride is a protest. When I see a gathering or people, we need to educate them. So I just went out and I had that t-shirt just to raise awareness what home office says about Black, about especially African people, because they always expect us to adopt the way lesbians in this country behave, how they dress up, how they talk. The people were volunteering for LISC, they had a hard time because I would ask them, how do I dress up if someone is going to court? How does a lesbian woman look like? Because we didn't know, and the judge wanted you to look like a lesbian woman. So this is one of the t-shirts that I wore on that Manchester Pride, that you are not muscular enough to be gay, to be lesbian, to be bisexual. It was said by one of the judges here in Manchester in 2016. So I had to go around Manchester Pride wearing that. Now, my worry is with COVID-19 that is happening now, some of us, we had that opportunity to attend Manchester Pride, to attend LGBT events so that we can take pictures and it can show that we belong to this community. These people that are on lockdown, they've been home since in March, in the beginning of this year. They don't have evidence. This kind of evidence that home office needs, they don't have it. They're just at home. They don't have the evidence to show that they're gay or they're bisexual. They are just saying it without any evidence and proof in their houses. So what is going to happen to them? Which means they're going to be detained and deported and sent back to their countries where they feel unsafe. Whereas their living condition right now, they're sharing houses, maybe four or three people. If one of them is got COVID, they also supposed to isolate, but they cannot isolate because home office requires you to go and report. They call it welfare check. And like I say that, I don't believe it's welfare check. It's just a punishment because you're an asylum seeker. They need to make your life miserable. So my friends, they're still going to report in Dallas Court, Salford, in wherever they live. so that the home office, they'll know that they're still at home, they're not running away, and they're risking other people, because with this COVID, it's not only asylum seekers or black and brown community that are affected, it's everyone that will meet on the way when you are going to the reporting centers. And you cannot break that law because they want you to go. If you call them this week that you've got the symptoms, you can't go, then they will tell you that, okay, you need to isolate for 2 weeks. The next week, you need to come here. We want to see you. So, which means whatever NHS is doing, trying so hard to fight this COVID, the pandemic, it's not going to end anytime soon, as long as asylum seekers are still being treated in this way. So what can you do? Some of you, you didn't know what was happening out there. Now that you've got a little information that I tried to share with you, it's campaigning, campaigning, and campaigning, and campaigning. We need to fight. We need to change all these, especially when it comes to asylum seekers, because it doesn't matter whether they're LGBT plus or they're just simple asylum seekers, but whatever it affects them, whatever the laws that they put for them affects the LGBT asylum seekers. And those are the most vulnerable asylum seekers. If you can sit down with them and hear their stories, you'll find out that their journeys has not been very easy. For someone to be standing up tall and being strong, if you just open up and sit down with them, you find that it's really difficult. We don't have coming out stories. We don't have the Manchester Pride or these London Pride. We've never attended once. We only got here. We're like, oh, okay, a rainbow flag flying sky high. You will never see that in Africa. So people are coming here fighting for love, looking for love. And to our fellow sisters and brothers, British brothers, love us despite of our color. Be there for us in whichever way, like I say that, especially if you campaign, if you see any petition that is talking about asylum seekers, remember this talk today, that you'll be saving somebody's life. You'll be changing some laws and things for the other people who will be coming here seeking sanctuary. That's what we'll be doing. So that is why at the end of the day, I had to choose to work with Right to Remain, because they're fighting for asylum seekers, they're fighting for refugees. So if you go to their website, These Walls Must Fall website, you'll find the petitions that we are doing, the campaigns that we are doing to change the asylum system. Right now there is COVID. We don't need anyone to go out there saying that they're going to signing and reporting because Home Office wants to make sure they're safe. They are depressed enough already, those people. They don't have entertainment in their houses. They are confined in one small bedroom for the rest of their days as long as they're in lockdown. There is not much space that you can exercise, you can stretch your feet, you can change channels. There is nothing. That's where they live. And they have to worry about their cases, if they're going to be refused or not. And the organizations that are supporting asylum seekers that have been self-set, you can donate to them. You can, if you go to the website, any organization, not only LISC, not only Movement for Justice, just with the little that I have, donate and support them. Thank you.
Amazing. Thank you both so much for that talk. It was great to have the historical context there, as well as that current experience and kind of looking at that impact of the history on today, really, and yeah, how it still is affecting people's personal lives. And especially thank you to you, Maggie, for sharing your experience with us.